Media Group, and I will be the moderator for today's session. The first IHF live online symposium is part of the Virtual Academy, recently launched by the IHF to provide opportunities for global online education and online licensing. All of this falls under the umbrella of the IHF Education Center, available at ihfeducation.ihf.info. Over the next 5 weeks, a total of 20 live online seminars will be presented by top handball experts from around the world. The topics will focus mainly on coaching and refereeing subjects, but are of interest to all handball enthusiasts and all are welcome to attend. As today is the first session, we will begin with a welcome from IHF President Dr. Hassan Mustafa.
Hello. Good afternoon, good morning, good evening, because we are different countries from different continents. I'm very pleasure to be with you today and welcome to the IHF Live Online Symposium. The current situations with the COVID-19 has forced us to find the new ways to grow, develop, and improve handball around the world. Therefore, the IHF created the IHF Virtual Academy, which shall service online all our handball family. The symposium will be the best online tool to help growing our sport. So I encourage all our handball family to take part in these symposiums, be it now or in the futures. I would like to convey my gratitude to everyone who helped to organize this symposium. I am happy to welcome participants from all over the world. We have today about 5,000 participants, which prove the interest of our handball family to develop and to promote their knowledges. This symposium has gathered some of the best and most knowledgeable handball minds from around the world. IHF experts, just as well as top coaches and top referees, to present a wide variety of topics. I look forward to this symposium, during which the hot topics in current handball are discussed. I also look forward to have a cooperation between coaches and the referees during the matches. But you will also learn about defense, attack, specific rules, goalkeepers. You should now, the IHF is trying to reduce the aggressiveness of handball and increase at the same time the speed to be more attractive. Thank you to all our chairman. It means I'm speaking about the chairman of CCM, Mr. Dietrich Peter, and also the chairman of PRC, the referee commissions, Mr. Gallego, and the lectors and IHF staff, all participants. I wish everyone a great symposium and advise the follow the IHF Virtual Academy. And hereby, I declare the first IHF online symposium. Stay healthy and safe. Thank you so much for everyone and very good luck. And we'll be in contact. I am also now ready before starting. If anyone you have any comment, you have any questions to IHF, I am ready to listen to anyone you have any things from our side. Thank you so much. Very good luck.
Thank you, President. The first lecture today will be presented by Jochen Beppler, head coach of the younger age category national teams at the German Handball Federation and IHF analyst. Translation is available by clicking the interpretation button at the bottom of your screen. There's French, Spanish, and Arabic translation available. For Arabic, you need to click Japanese, as there is no button for Arabic available. Please remember also to mute the original audio when using the translation function. Throughout the lecture, please feel free to ask questions. I will compile the questions for Jochen, and we will have two breaks during his presentation, as well as some time for questions at the end. And then we're ready to begin, Jochen.
Thank you so much, Courtney. Yeah, and then we are ready to start. Yeah, thank you so much. Hi and hello to everybody around the globe. I hope you're all in good health and you are as well looking confidently ahead to the day that handball returns to courts around the world, as the president has said in March. And at this stage of the symposium, I also want to say thank you to the president and the IHF for giving the opportunity to coaches and referees all around the world to connect, to discuss, and most of all, helping our sports to develop and progress worldwide. As you have probably heard, that the presentation's name for today is Creating Spaces in Attack. I've provided a short schedule for the way we're going to proceed within this talk. And as Courtney has already said, I've divided the presentation into three parts so that we will have two breaks after 20 minutes, probably, so that it's easier to follow or to answer questions within the presentation. Okay, so we're going to start with the first chapter, which is called Handball is a Developing Game. And therefore, I want to look and analyze the finals of the Olympic Games from 2016 until 1980, because in these pictures, in these moving pictures, you can see best that handball has developed extremely. Let's start with the Olympics 2016.
The men's Olympic handball final, France against Denmark at the Future Arena. France, the lure of gold, made it a fast physical encounter from the start. The French were alert and ruthless.
You see Denmark, the new rules playing 7-6. You see a high-speed game.
It was a tight first half.
And you see
changing hands several times.
Technically specialized players on the wings.
Hansen and Lasse Svan took Denmark clear.
And as I already said, a high-speed game, highly attractive to spectators, not only in Rio.
Full time. France dethroned Denmark, the new Olympic champions.
So this was the final 2016. And as I said, let's have a throwback to 1980, to the final in Moscow, to see how handball has developed.
Самых драматичных матчей в истории мирового гандбола. Где-то далекого 1980 года финальный поединок мужского гандбольного турнира между командами ГДР и Советского Союза. Думаю, что кто в какой форме играет, представлять не надо. Сразу о составах. Немцы сейчас в атаке. По краям Хартл Крюгер и Ханс Георг Байер.
Yeah, and after this
after только что
забыл, goal from Lothar Dörving and the Olympic champion, the former GDR, I want to stop with the moving pictures. And I think you could perfectly see in the video throwback that the game has developed extremely. And now I want to have a look at the game in figures and statistics, because they are different in a way. And they deliver data in a more reliable way. So the first data I want to draw your attention to is the to the line player, where we can see that 25% of all the goals are scored by the line player up to the World Championships 2015. And the second thing I want to draw your attention to is the increase of efficiency, not only in for wing players, but also in breakthroughs, where you can see that we have highly specialized players on the different positions. The last thing I want to show, or I want to draw your attention to, is the decrease in the number of attacks. In Qatar, only 54 attacks were played, while in London 2012, we had 60 attacks. So the number of attacks has decreased, but at the same time, the need for efficiency has increased. So let's look at those figures in a short summary. One of four goals is scored by the pivot or the line player. We have less attacks, which speaks for improved defense against fast breaks because our game is still very fast. But at the same time, we have an increase in attack efficiency. And we have a significant increase of the shooting efficiency from the wings and with breakthroughs. So this is what the statistics say and deliver, as well as the moving pictures, that handball is a developing game. And as you can see, the trend has carried on. If we have a look at the figures of the World Championships 2019 in Germany and Denmark, we can see that the number of attacks still has gone down, and the efficiency has even gone up at the same time. These were the figures for men's handball. And let's look at women's handball just to have a comparison to that. We have a significant less efficiency from backcourt players, but we have much more attacks with 59 and a lower number, lower efficiency in the attacking efficiency. So this is what we can say with pictures, movies, and statistic figures, how handball has developed. The second chapter is called It's All About Spaces, because based on the statistics we just saw, we can say that there are three different zones related to attractiveness and dangerousness for the attack. I want you to look on picture one. Just on the left side, we have three zones in three different colors. The first and most dangerous zone is the red one, or the orange one, you might call it, because from this zone, attack has the highest efficiency. They are able to score from good angles, or they are close to the goal, or what is even important for this zone, that we have many rules which can be applied in this zone, like earning a 7-meter throw or a suspension for a foul. So this is the most dangerous zone. The second most dangerous zone is the yellow one. We've just heard that we have an increase in efficiency from the wing players. So a high efficiency as well from the yellow zone with many specialists. And I'm not sure if Ramon Galeco will also refer to the rules to protect those wing players, which were really relevant throughout the last years. And then the third zone, the green one, is not as dangerous as the other two, but because the distance to the goal is bigger and the efficiency goes down. But we all know that there are still a lot of players who are dangerous enough to score even from greater distances. On pictures two and three, you can just see possible strategies to defend the zones in different ways, like in a 6-0 defense or in a 3-2-1 defense. So thinking about those spaces, I was somehow reminded of the relationship and the relatedness of handball to other games, such as soccer, basketball, hockey, or American football. And if I had to define handball in one sentence, I would say that handball is a thrilling and a popular mixture of offense and defense. Handball is thrilling because it's so full of speed. It has so many changes and it's a really fast game. And from my point of view, it's also popular because it unites and contains so much that other sports can only offer in a more isolated way, because we are attractive in offense and defense. And that is why I do not share the opinion of a former NFL player, Jay Cutler, who was asked about handball, and he said that he could easily form a competitive team that could win a gold medal in the Olympic Games. Or said something about the goalkeepers, and I think Mats will contradict this tomorrow. But I do not share this opinion because, as I just said in my definition about handball, I think it's thrilling and unites more than only one popular feature. For example, if you look at the recent developments in handball, the president has also spoken about that, about rule development being more attractive. We have an interesting and intensive game in defense where we find and see the progress in active defense play, where it is more about winning the ball than only destroying the game. And therefore, a high precision in technique is afforded. But we are not only attractive in defense play, handball is also emotional and inspirational in offense, where the importance of tactics comes into play by making use of feints, of blocks, and teamwork in general. And it's also in offense where we have so many brilliant world-class players that make handball so attractive. So from my point of view, handball is both. Handball has shown a great development in offense and defense. It's about making use of little space in handball and offense, or defending that space in a smart way. And there will also be some lecturers like Jorge Duenas who will focus on defense in this virtual academy. And handball is not only a game for space, it's also about time. We're trying to create spaces or large spaces for a long time, or at least for as long as possible. So, and this leads us to the third chapter, good spaces in handball. What are good spaces? We already spoke about that it's attractive if we have a short distance, a good angle, or zones that are relevant for the application of some rules. But I think there's also another system which we could apply to say, or to have some kind of logic in describing or answering the question, what are good spaces? My colleague Axel Kromer published in his book the following graphics, where he says, the best space is where you have superiority in a large space, as you can see on the left picture. This is the best situation you can achieve or you can create. The second best is having superiority in little space. And the third one is equality in large space. All those three situations are commonly regarded as tactically correct, as Axel Kromer says in his book, Positionstraining. But there are also spaces and zones that are not that attractive. For example, equality in little space, or if you are short-handed, playing 2 against 3 in a large space, and the worst situation you could face is being short-handed in little space only. So generally speaking, you could say these three situations are commonly regarded as tactically wrong if you have the opportunity to create a superiority or large spaces. So let's look at these spaces in a hierarchy. superiority in large space would be the best situation you could achieve, whereas the worst situation is playing short-handed in little space. So after this first part, let's have a look at our schedule, what we have already covered, the developing game, the question, it's all about spaces, and the question, what are good spaces and situations? We're going to have a short break now for some 3 or 4 minutes. And after that, we're dealing with how to create spaces and the technical requirements, tactical knowledge, and the summary. So for this first part, I pass the floor to Courtney and see you in 2 or 3 minutes again.
Hello, everyone. I see so far most of the questions have been about translation and the lecture being available later. The Arabic translation is available under Japanese. You just need to press the interpretation button and you can find it there. The video will also be available later on ihfeducation.ihfinfo as part of the video library. So all of these presentations will be available for you to watch on demand later. Jochen, so far there's no questions for your lecture. Everybody, please feel free to ask questions. I know Jochen is very happy to discuss your questions, so that's what we're here for. Please don't hold back if you have anything to ask. And we're ready whenever you're ready to proceed.
Okay. So then we can move, thanks Courtney, we can move on to the second part. Maybe then the questions will arise because we're dealing with the practical part from now on. So after having dealt with the introduction and the thoughts connected, we now want to dip into practice and want to have a look at this chapter, how to create those spaces, and also how we can practice this with our teams in the gym. Let me say at the beginning of this chapter that all the ideas proposed in the following steps for the practical sessions were recorded with great talents from the NECA Academy of Balaton Boklar in March. So at this point of the presentation, my special thanks goes to Hungary. So for the following 25 minutes, I prepared different chapters for you that all contribute answers to the question, how can we create spaces in attack? And here you see a complete overview, but I will also introduce every single point separately. Let's focus on the question, what is a dangerous attacker? A dangerous attacker is in possession of the ball. He or she is able to shoot or attack from a good angle, in great space with no or only few defenders. That would be perfect situations. And he or she attacks with high velocity. So we know quite a lot about handball, but the question now is, how do we do that? How do we achieve those situations? My first suggestion is opening the central spaces with transitions from the left back or right back. At this point, I also want to say that you can also find those clips as well as many, many more articles from IHF analysts in the IHF Education Center. So, opening central spaces, what are you going to see in the movies? We will here see the transition from right back and the shift of the center back to the right side. And what you can see already on this slide is that the center defenders move and adapt to this situation, and that we create a situation where the central space is open and the space between defender number 3 and 4 is really, really big, so that they can play or achieve superiority or advantage in this situation. So Let's see how this looks in practice with clips from the IHF Youth World Championships 2019 in North Macedonia. In the first clip, you can see a transition from left back player and the large space in the center for center back and right back. And right back uses this large space for a one-on-one and a goal afterwards. The second situation is done by Brazil. Again, a transition from left back, and then the space in this situation is used by right back for the jump shot and the goal to equalize 14-14. It's again Brazil in the third clip. And this clip is also interesting. After the transition, the left back supports now with a move the situation. When the ball comes back to left back, he opens space to the outside position and left wing can score a goal. A very nice variation, awesome goal by Brazil. In this last clip, we have a transition of left back again, but another position of the line player, so that we have a cooperation in two against two here, and a second two against two cooperation, which the line player uses for his goal. So, how can we practice this situation, a transition from left back? Now we see situations from the practical session with the girls of NECA Academy in Hungary.
Passes the ball to the goalkeeper, runs this way. You can stand here. Yeah, let the ball drop. Do not let it bounce. Catch it before it, then throw it back. In the center, get the ball, and you can start already. Yes, get the ball and throw. Okay, so when she gets the ball, you start on this side. Okay.
Okay, so you can see here movements to open spaces by left back and right back, and we can make use of a time that is needed
open
anyway, like the goalkeeper warm up.
Receiving the ball in movement. Yes. Good job.
Okay. So this could be a first step introducing transitions from left back or right back. The second one is shown in this exercise, two against two, plus two supporters. You see, we play the two against two in the central space as it occurs after the transition.
Next group.
This is the situation after the transition. The two defense players in the orange shirt.
Good. Good job in defense. Yes. Three more groups.
You You see, it takes some time for the attackers to increase speed to attack the goal with high velocity.
Good job in defense.
And only if they attack with high velocity,
and stop.
They can increase their chances.
Please change the defenders.
And what they have to try is to play that one-on-one with more seriousness.
They are passing the ball too quickly. They have to use the great space on one against one. Go for the goal, play one against one in this large space. Do not pass the ball too quickly. You can pass the ball to your colleague. If you have won that one-on-one, win that one-on-one, and if she is coming, and then you pass the ball, yeah? Go towards the goal.
So a last situation,
yes,
before we move on. Here you see more seriousness in the one-on-one and higher velocity of the attackers. She also made use of a pass feint, which is awesome. So third idea, how we could translate this strategy into practice is the same two against two with an initial transition of the left back player. So we have combined two situations, the goalkeeper warm up and the two against two as it occurs after the transition.
Okay.
Transition of left back, opening the space for the two against two.
Stop.
Here you can see more velocity, and then they are able to use the space. Now we move on to the next step, four against four. Only the wing players are missing now.
You get the ball, bounce, and then you go. Okay? And now, okay.
So we have the four against four.
Next step, from two against two to four against four. Okay, start.
Left back starts with a transition.
Stop.
And what we can see here, it's really nice because left back is not supporting the background players, the backcourt players.
To work for your players in the center.
She's more an obstacle.
So this is why you go here and get her here, so they have more space now. Good for offense? Good for offense? Yes, and that's your job, you're an offense player. So now they have place and space for playing two against two. And if she wins, go in this sector, and she helps, you stay here. Yeah, you do not go here, okay.
What was great in Hungary that you can see that they are really able to adapt quickly.
Yes, good job. Yes, super.
The open space very well, and you see that technique is only a necessity to play situations like that.
Good job. Yes.
Two perfect solutions quickly adapted by the girls of NECA Academy. It was really a pleasure working with them. We come to the second suggestion for creating spaces in attack. Again, we focus on the central space in the backcourt, and a common tool, a common mean is crossing without the ball in the backcourt players, among the backcourt players. I try to draw this on this handball court as well so that you know what is awaiting you in the movie afterwards. So the center back player with number three is shifting to the left and takes number three in defense with him. And Behind him, left back crosses without the ball and can now attack with the ball from a good angle and with high speed. Remember our first slide. A dangerous attacker has the ball, is able to shoot or attack from a good angle in great space. This cannot be applied here, but he attacks or she attacks with high velocity. Let's see how this looks like with two clips from the Euro 2020, both of Portugal. In the first clip, Rui Silva from Portugal is attacking that space marked on the video now. And he is supported by his line player, Frade, who runs away to make it more difficult for defense. In the second clip, again, the interesting space is marked. André Gomes is shooting from a good angle and scores this goal for Portugal. You all know that Portugal was able to defeat the French team in the Euro, and they did a great job. It was awesome watching them. So, third suggestion, let's move on to the pivot or the line player, who is often called a second playmaker. And I think this is really a true thing. After center back, the pivot player, the line player is the second playmaker. How come or why is this the case? He or she can either help to create spaces, or he or she is more like an obstacle for the backcourt players. One thing that is often played with the line player is that crossing of center back with the line player. And you can see again, left back goes to center back then. And what can be observed quite often if we have that crossing of center back with the line player is that the offense comes up to 9 meters, which creates spaces in their backs, either for a transition of the wing players or for the line player to move in those spaces. So let's look at some clips where this happens. It's again from the Euro 2020. The first one is from the Netherlands.
So after 2-0 opening, Germany have finally settled into their stride a little bit here.
They do not score a goal in this scene, but after this crossing, the line player can run after or behind Hendrik Pekela, which makes it necessary for the defense to switch, and so more spaces are created. And the second example, with the line player Bence Banhidi from Hungary, you can see how Hungary makes use of the space. The Danish defense is quite close in this situation, but they are open. They are at the 9-meter line. So maybe a transition from right wing might also work. But Bence Banhidi is causing the problem that the defenders have to talk about which one of them is responsible for him. Before we have a second break in my presentation, I want to focus on the line player as a second playmaker, because he's not only important in this common crossing, which all of us probably know, but he's also responsible or important for supporting moves, where he or she increases the space and supports the backcourt players instead of being an obstacle. Let's look at some scenes where the line player supports.
Back into the action.
Only one scene. We already had that crossing without the ball in the backcourt.
Along with Gensheimer.
And then the line player, Yannick Kohlbacher here, you see him in the spot in some seconds, is supporting the backcourt players. You see the spot about Kohlbacher now. He's supporting by running away in this moment and giving Fabian Böhn a good chance to score. I've also provided some other supporting moves from line players from Champions League, which I want to show you now, just to prove that the line player can really help to create spaces. First example, Porto against Kielce. The line player Borges is running away, and I've also marked the distances between the defense players. You can see this now, the distance of the defense players is marked in yellow. And here the space for that one-on-one is so big that the defender has no chance to defend it. Second example is taken from Veszprém. We see a transition of right back by Yahya Omar. And we see Peter Nenadic also shifting on the right side. And with his pass to Rasmus Lauge, Nilsson at the line opens the space for this one-on-one of Rasmus Lauge. So supporting moves of the line players are really a good mean, a good tool to support the backcourt players. Flensburg. After the transition of the right wing and his moving back, his running back to the right wing, the line player Anders Zachariasen supports it, and Simon Jepsen with a great and fantastic pass to left wing to Magnus Jondal. We can see a similar situation in the next example by Flensburg. Here, Johannes Goller at the line is supporting an open space for Jim Gottfriedson. And what is really awesome in this clip, you can watch now at Jim Gottfriedson. He also plays a faint pass to the line player and then is able to score from the backcourt. Yeah, and this was the second part of my presentation. I'm going to pass the floor again to Courtney so that you have a short break and can relax for some minutes until we come to the third part where we will also see some clips from Japan 2019 and the women's handball. Courtney, thanks.
We do have some questions this time. Two related questions about adjusting tactics. If the other team starts to be aware of the tactics you're employing. For example, someone asked about in this four against four example with the NECA girl, the academy, mm-hmm. They asked if you can skip the center back and pass directly to the back. I think the main theme is how to coach the creativity when you have also these set plays and tactics.
I think that's really a good question. And from my point of view, two things we have to look at. The first one is that we enable our players with the technical necessities to realize all the different solutions we maybe have in mind, and also to encourage them to think in this creative way and to teach them some tactical knowledge about handball. If they know what are good spaces, they might come with their own ideas and they are more focused on following them, or they are more convinced of following them. So I'd really support the idea of encouraging players to get and to think about handball, to get that tactical knowledge. I think it's important for them to encourage them thinking about it.
And someone else is asking about creating spaces for the left and right back if the defence stand on the line. A lot of the examples, I think, were showing a more open defence.
Mm-hmm. As we have started the presentation with the facts and figures and the statistics, we can see that many goals are scored in the different zones, and they are different in their dangerousness. But we will also focus on some ideas and suggestions what we can do if the defense stays more defense in a more defensive way within the next part of the presentation.
Let's try this last one. It might be a bit challenging to answer quickly. How do you make a right-handed right back more effective?
First of all, I'd say what you could do with a right-handed right back is thinking about what are the advantages of such a situation. And this could be playing to the outside and not making him doing what a left-handed player would do, so that we could really make use of his strengths. Because first of all, I'd say if we have right-handed players who are talented enough to also play the right back position, does not or still makes it necessary to work with them and teach them also techniques going to the non-throwing arm side, we say in Germany. I do not know the right English expression, but making use of their strengths and advantages, first of all.
I think we'll leave that. Yeah, we'll leave the rest of the questions for after, if you would like to continue.
Yeah, thank you. And thanks to all the colleagues for your questions. I always appreciate getting into discussions, although we are miles and kilometers apart. Yeah, let's move to the fourth point. I want to focus now on center back, shifting his or her position for isolating one defender. And in a second step, we also use the shifting of center back for the line player again to support his counter movement action by a block. And I've tried to draw this on the handball court again, the shifting of center back, which should open spaces against a defense that is more 6-0 like. You see here, first, like in the initial transition, left back attacks the space between defender one and two, and center back shifts into the greater space between the two defenders two and three. And what we achieve is an isolated one against one in large space. So this might be a good option for players who are strong enough to use this one-on-one space. And here the line player is not needed. That is why he's outside the court between defender five and six. And what could arise from such a situation is also a crossing of a left-handed right back with a right-handed center back. So let's look at how this was used during the World Championships of Women in Japan 2019. In the first clip, we have an isolation of Senegal's number 45. And I think it's Ms. Hafra playing one-on-one and crossing for this goal. Again, we have isolation of number 45. And indicated the spaces between the players. This time the cross is not successful, but we have superiority in little space or large space, which is taken advantage of by Hungary's left wing. Now we see Japan.
Takes over in the middle. She'll switch back again. She's naturally a right back.
This is really well done. You see the line player between position one and two, and now the shifting of the attack to the right side. And then the isolation for one against one, or a quick step shot, like in this example. Again, Japan, now the other side.
Shooting against Argentina today, 71% against Congo. Congo team down at 47%, which is about where they were in their opening game against Sweden.
So shifting position, and as I said in the beginning, this zone number one, which is most dangerous, is also relevant for so many rules, like this 7 meter throw in this situation. So I said I want to start with the center back shifting his or her position. And the next point, next suggestion is that we do not only have center back shifting the position, but also having the line player supporting his move, his counter move. What is interesting in this situation is that it can happen during the match or also as a common tool for continuing after free throws. How does it look like? We have the shifting to the left and we divide the defense into two parts. And when center back is making his counter movement, the line player is supporting this counter movement by a block. And we have this situation afterwards where we can find different solutions, like playing with the line player or playing the wave to right back or the right wing. So I decided only to choose clips how this situation looks like after free throws. So enjoy those clips where the shifting of center back is supported by the line player. So in the first situation, Borges was the line player, and in the second one, we have Daimaro Salina as a line player and Miguel Martins on center back. The free throw starts and we have a shifting to the right, opening space for the line player to get into his position. And then the cooperation between center back and line player. Now we see Kielce with a different position of the line player.
Atman not a happy camper at all. Lovely ball, lovely ball, lovely goal!
This is a situation which we find quite often in Spanish teams as well. It's awesome how Igor Karacic and Artem Karalek are cooperating and how they create this space after a free throw. In the two scenes we are going to see now, it's not a center back who's cooperating with the line player, but it's the wing players. But the center back again supports this by shifting away, opening space, and enjoy the last two clips. So here we do not really have a counter movement by center back, but starting after a free throw. And center back supports this by opening the space, by shifting more to the left side. Karabatic in this case. We come to a quite similar scene with Beckham. This time, Peter Nenadic is supporting the space, opening the space by shifting away, and Nilsson is going into that block, receives the ball with one hand, and a spectacular shot, quite a nice clip. So how could this look like in practice? Again, the girls from Neckar show us quite an interesting exercise. In this exercise, the line player wears the orange shirt because center back doesn't. So the first two actions was not what I was looking for, so listen to my correction in a few seconds.
First pass, remember, in a game, somebody will be standing here. The only pass is on this side. You cannot pass here, okay? Okay, only there. And if the ball goes here, you try to block her, okay?
So this exercise
needs very good.
The ability to catch with one hand.
Good in defense. Good job.
This is a nice pass.
Yeah. Perfect.
And this is where you could stop a practice. Excellent behavior of the line player because she adapts the second block. The first block is well done already, but she adapts very well after the first pass. Another exercise which we showed in Hungary is a 2-against-2 with an off-limit zone for bouncing, which is indicated by the white stripes on the floor. So center back is not allowed to bounce the ball because we want a clear shifting of center back and a supporting block.
There's
by
only
the line
space
player
for a short time. Good job.
Center back can shift to both sides.
No.
And they have only limited space naturally for this exercise. So nice passes, technique again.
Good.
Is absolutely necessary, and they have only short time for decision taking.
With the defenders. Good.
Perfect. It's awesome.
Come on with the defenders.
Yeah. This brings us to technical requirements. As you could see in this exercise, only if technique is in the flow, we can realize tactical ideas. If we do not have proper technical skills, we do not need to start thinking about any of the suggested tactics. And as basic skills, all our players should learn or have is catching, passing, also feints in throwing and passing, everything in motion, but with the add-ons also, which are precision, variations, velocity, and also having chain of techniques like doing a pass feint and playing one-on-one after this. So combining different actions in a chain of techniques. Technique's function is really relevant. That is why we did also an exercise with the girls at Neckar, practicing passing techniques for cooperation with the line player.
Okay.
Here the girls practice in a triangle, different techniques of playing the ball to the line player.
But first,
because they are necessary for the different tactics.
You too, huh? No?
Keep. Okay, we can go on. I want to go into the direction to come to the end of my presentation. And I want to think with you about what is the right tactic. We have proposed some suggestions of how to create spaces. And then the question arises, what is the right tactic? I think there are different criteria. And from my experience of working in the German Federation with all the young players, is that first of all, we should focus on the level of skills, the level of training of our players, because often it's the case, or nearly always it's the case, that basics limit everything. So my experience really is to emphasize this, the right tactic is always based on the level of training of our players. The second thing is players' requirements. Because if we choose a tactic with blocks, we need line players, maybe which are physically strong enough, but they need the level of training and the technical demands. And then the right tactic is also related to adapting the tactics to the opponent. But as you can see in this pyramid, two-thirds of the pyramid are related to our job, are related to what we can do, and only one third is connected to the opponent. And when dealing with the question, what is the right tactics? I think we should also think about tactical knowledge, that we need players who are able to read and understand the game. And again, I made use of my first comparison of handball to other sports, like comparing handball to American football. You could definitely say that if handball has a quarterback, then it's the center back position. So, and for example, I want to show you this slide where you can see that the tactical knowledge of the center back is really relevant and decides so much in our game. On picture one, you can see a transition from the left wing. And you see also the zones, the red, the yellow, and the green one, which are not that important at the moment. But on picture two, you can see if center back shifts to the right after this transition from left wing, he opens space for a two against two of left back and the line player. This is one possibility. And the second possibility is in picture three, if the line player shifts to the left side, he opens space for a two against two, maybe with a crossing. And this, for my understanding, is a perfect example that center back is really so important. He has to read and understand the game. And let's look at this behavior in a clip where we see the same start and three different situations. Transition of left wing. Here we see the transition of the left wing. And center back shifting to the left, and we see the two against two on the right side, because there is space for it. Second situation. Same start, but now center back is shifting to the right and opens the space for cooperation left back and line player. So in the third clip, we have the cooperation with the line player, and with small difference, you can perfectly demonstrate how center back has a great impact on our game and where we could make use of our strengths and strong players. Yeah, let's come to a summary at this point. I can say again, handball is a thrilling and popular mixture of offense and defense. It's about creating and preparing spaces and in attack. And it's about defending in a smart way and with high precision. And I'd say at the moment we are experiencing a trend in defense play that is not yet over. And so handball is the sport that is represented by all those coaches, players. Sorry to Ramon, also the referees are a part of this, but handball is represented by all those players and coaches, and not only those coaches and players who are in the focus of media, but also of all coaches joining this course, all of you and all of us who are contributing something to develop handball all around the world. And especially during this corona time and after the lock time, I think many people thought, like the famous Argentinian football coach Cesar Menotti, who once said, for society, football, and I'd say you can replace that easily with handball, has the same function like other expressions of art. A good movie, a good song. That's the point where I want to end my presentation. Thank you for joining this course. Thanks all the translators. Thanks you, Courtney, for hosting. And I'd also like to recommend you the next presentations of Ramon and also Mats Olsson for tomorrow. Thank you so much. And I hope you could enjoy or could learn something. Have a great Friday, and goodbye from my point of view. I'll pass the floor to you, Courtney.
We do actually just have a few questions before you disappear, Jochen.
Okay.
Let's begin with, there's some questions about pivot positioning. So maybe we could talk a bit more about this direct, indirect block. There's a lot of just general questions about pivot positioning during this creating space.
Yeah.
So can you speak a bit more to that?
Okay, I have some slides which might be useful for explaining that. But first of all, I want to say that there is a huge difference also in the philosophy of some nations. In Spanish philosophy, you mostly find the line player in the position between defender number 2 and 3. So there's also a difference in philosophy. But maybe I could make a remark on line player's position by explaining the difference between a direct block and an indirect block, which we also saw in the exercise with the NECA girls. In this situation, we see a direct block because the line player is blocking the direct opponent of the left back player. If the left back player now moves into the center, the defense has to react by communicating and making a switch who's responsible for which player. So this might cause a problem for them, or they have to find a different strategy that the defense player that is being blocked goes up so that they stay man-man oriented. Maybe this is also a thing of tactical knowledge which we should teach our line players. And in the clip we saw about NECA, the girl at the line did this perfectly, adapting her block. And the second thing as a block is this indirect block, where the line player supports the backcourt players by blocking the defense to move on. And to help creating large spaces because the defense cannot get closer. And by blocking this second defender, he enables left back player to play one. And if he would move inside, he might be more an obstacle than a real supporter. If he is blocking in that indirect way, he opens space maybe for a pass, but also for the left back player to play one-on-one without the help of the second defender, which is blocked by the line player. Maybe this might be an additional help. I hope so. Courtney, I cannot hear you.
Sorry, I muted myself. We also have some questions about 7 against 6. What do you think about this in terms of creating space? Because of course, it also there maybe is more chance to draw defenders, but at the same time, there's another person taking up more space.
I think you can look at this question from two different perspectives. Me, as I'm responsible for all our youth players and the talents that have to grow up, I do not. I'm not a great fan of 7 against 6 because my point of view is that we should teach players to win one-on-one situations because this is characteristic for our game, and not being in superiority without doing anything, because then it's only just finding the right player who is not defended at this moment. I really want to teach players how to win those one-on-one situations, or how to create spaces where they have bigger chances to play one-on-one. Mm-hmm. And the second thing is that you can, and my perspective, gone through their development, through the different stages of their development, and you might look at this question completely different. These are two possible ways to deal with that.
Okay, and some people have asked also about creating space when there's 3-3 defense. Yes, can you explain a bit about that?
I guess in those situations where we have defense in a more offensive position, like 3-3 defense, a transition from left back or right back might be the right mean or tool to open that central space and enable the other two players to come with high velocity to have large space for one-on-one and the following decision. So a transition from left back or right back might be something really good, because if the defense is out of the 9-meter area, it's more difficult for the line players to block somebody. They cannot be so precise.
And let's do one more, just about creating space, how to help creating space opposite to the direction of the ball. So the players who don't have the ball, how they can learn about helping to create the space.
I think there's a good tendency at the moment how players not having the ball could help, because the only thing we have to do is transfer our knowledge from the supporting movements a line player does, which are also possible for wing players. There's a tendency at the moment, I think, Flensburg, I'm not sure if there might be some other teams doing that as well, having a line player inside the 6-meter or 9-meter area and supporting by going away when a certain pass is played and to enlarge the space. I think this is rather interesting how handball is going to develop in the next years, in the years to come. If we have more moves like running away from sectors, opening space for one-on-one, and we have some philosophies like the Spanish one as well, where the line player is not running that much, but supporting more with indirect blocks, creating the space for backward players.
That's the end of the questions then, and we'll say thank you very much, and then I'll sign off for us.
Yeah, thank you.
So thank you very much, everyone, for your attendance at the first session. I hope this has been enlightening for you. The session has been recorded and will be available for on-demand viewing on the IHF Education Centre, ihfeducation.ihf.info. We have the next session coming up. That is with the chairman of the IHF Playing Rules and Referees Commission, Ramon Galejo. The focus for this is on the progressive line concerning rules 8.3 and 8.4 and the IHF guidelines for implementing these. So this is particularly interesting for referees, but also very interesting for coaches in order to understand the line that the IHF is enforcing, and also that this line should be applied broadly across the world. So it is a very important topic for everyone. So I hope you can join us for that. Thank you very much. Bye.